Thank you for your time. We really appreciate, you know, I know everyone's very busy and appreciate you taking time out of your schedule to give us this opportunity to talk to you about what we're doing and give us these awesome tours. This is my first opportunity actually to be at Kennedy other than just a normal tourist. So it's very nice to, you know, couple this with some of the stuff that we've done with Ames and Marshall and Johnson. So I'm going to give a very brief kind of overview. I don't want to take too much time, so we make sure that we can focus on what the students have been working on this last year. So as I mentioned, this is the team for this year, for this spring, and I'll talk a little bit about how we kind of structure that with the courses. We do try to make this as multidisciplinary as possible. Some years it's more multi than others, and this year it's obviously very aero focused. And our team last year, we had quite a bit more diversity. It was actually a lot more cumbersome in terms of getting people together and to focus on that that one project. So a little bit of history from our perspective. We did start back with this in year one of X-Hab, and we had a lot of learning to go on through that first year, just like NASA did, you know, where we had to build the module for the DSH, take it down to Johnson, and everyone goes, wow, we never want to do that again. It was a hard experience for I know for us as well as NASA, working long hours to get that integrated. And then starting from second year, we had our other module up here that you can see in the corner, which was a deployable habitat module. And after that, what we've really focused on is developing systems that we can use in the future, both for habitat research, but also education and outreach. And that's really been our focus, is every year to add something to these different modules. I'll talk a little bit about what we have in terms of our structure here. And how we kind of modeled this is we came up with what we call the Stafford Deep Space Habitat, after General Tom Stafford, who was a native Oklahoman and comes back to the state quite a bit and to talk about NASA and space activities. And so I really kind of focused on these different modules that would give us capability based around a mission to Mars, so with the transit habitats, and then actually getting to the surface of Mars itself. We'll go over the mission profile, but this is basically what we use for our structure, for the students to essentially design around with that concept in mind, so that way they can look at the mission requirements, both for getting there and then also for getting the crew back. So these are our current analogs that we have, the TransHab, the Rehab, and the OASIS. And I'll talk about each one of those in just a little bit, because the students are basing what they're working on this year on these current modules that we have. So the TransHab is based around the MPLM, so we use the basic MPLM structure to construct this this system. And you can see it going from concept. So the space-rated concept, and every year we work on a space-rated design, and then from that work directly to develop the Earth analog. So there's the Earth analog module, and here's the construction phase, and here's the final analog itself. And that year we had different aspects, which included a working aeroponics section, a exercise section, and then various other living habitats as well. And since then, we've also included a laboratory that we've got as a space station mock-up from the Stafford Museum in Weatherford. Here's some examples of kind of give you an idea of the inside of that. Again, the idea behind this was to have a non-rack-based design. So everything in there is configured for a non-rack-based system, and you can actually see the rack-based laboratory behind there. And this is the Rehab, which was designed to be a lander for a Mars mission. The goal behind this was to also use it to study habitability requirements based upon variable volume. So the design is actually set up so these walls can move in here inward. You see these tracks, so it goes from a maximum volume, which you see right here, to a minimum volume, just kind of based around the ladder, which goes up to the second floor with personal living quarters. So the first floor is reconfigurable, which you can kind of see right here with the maximum footprint and the minimum footprint. So that gives us the capability then to modify how we'd actually have that lower floor configured. Now these are the two modules that we're using for the study this year. So we're reconfiguring part of the first floor of the Rehab, as well as one section of the impeller, or the transap. And then last year, of course, we worked on the greenhouse, which Morgan came out and visited. This picture right there. This was probably the biggest group that we had, where we had students from mechanical and aerospace engineering, biosystems and ag engineering, architectural engineering, and we've also worked with interior design in the past, which has always been pretty interesting. That's extremely multidisciplinary. And it was really too big for us to be able to manage. And in this case, this greenhouse, it was designed, so the space-rated design, kind of based around this type of configuration, and then we would have that deploy, so from the lander in these green leaves. And so the analog was just one of these deployable green wing sections that we built. And last year, we also started the process of making architectural models for each one of these. So we're in the process of setting up a museum for all these the models that we've been developing. We've also recently acquired an extremely large stash of museum quality models from our aviation education program, since they've been doing NASA education for some years. So in the process of setting up a museum, not only for our students, but also for outreach. And that'll be located somewhere, so we've developed this facility called SHARC for Space Habitat Architecture and Research Center. So we have these three modules, our Transhab, Oasis, and Rehab, and then we have some expansion area in here as well for future missions. And then we'll have the museum off one of these wings. So how we typically do this is we have courses in the fall, which is an elective course for our aerospace engineering students, spacecraft design. And this is really a component of that. So X-Hab does not dominate the entire course, probably really only about a third of the content. And then a group of those students come directly from spacecraft design into their capstone design project. Now next year we're going to be doing that a little bit differently. We're going to have an integrated course instead between architecture and aerospace engineering. So truly interdisciplinary, and that will be a smaller group, and X-Hab will really just be a focus of that course at a much larger level than what we've done with the spacecraft design course. And so that's our fall team structure. So we had actually four design teams within this this course. And so essentially we opened it up this year, given these three modules that we have, what can the teams come up with that would improve these modules, as well as doing some deep space habitability research. So these are the four concepts that they came up with. One was a modular laboratory platform, another was convertible living quarters. So we decided to, based upon the manpower that we had in the spring, to not work on these two projects, and then follow up on these two, which is the integrated medical bay and the zero-gravity exercise system. And so these will be integrated into the rehab and the transhab, respectively, and these projects we'll talk about today. So with that, I'll go ahead and turn it over to the students.
My first dumb question for you is, I presume if this is funded by a NASA grant?
Yes, right? This is the National Space Grant Consortium. Uh-huh. So the funding comes directly from them.
And comes from AES.
And we have some funding from the Oklahoma Space Consortium that
we do, yes.
A little bit per travel.
It's a 10-year or 5-year or one year?
Oh, yeah, we apply every year.
You apply every year.
Yes, so it's a different proposal every year.
Okay. Yep.
And so, again, we've been, I think, very lucky that we've had the capability to be selected every year, the opportunity to work with NASA. Thank you. So, again, we appreciate that. Okay. With that, I'll hand it over to Brandon. Yes.
All right. My name's Brandon Millikin. I was part of the original team in the fall semester that came up with the integrated medical bay. So I'm going to do a recap for those who were there last semester and for those who didn't get to see it. I'll discuss the original concept and how we came up with it. So these are the team members. Consist of myself, Alex Garrison, Atticus Mullon, and Joseph Stephan. And the inspiration mainly came from, we looked at European movable apartments. We liked the way that you could store it up. It would help save volume, and it would maximize the use of it so you can pull out a wall. As you see on the top left, that's more of a bed. And we wanted to already take the existing medical bay that was in the rehab design. So here's the picture of what was created last year for the rehab. And our goal was to implement a reconfigurable first floor that also doubles as a medical bay for once the astronauts do arrive on Mars. So we had a couple of requirements we wanted to do. We wanted to optimize the materials for the cost and strength. An emphasis on weight and strength because we don't want it to weigh too much because we know we don't want it to. We want to minimize weight whenever we're going to space, but we still want it to be strong enough to be able to hold somebody on the bed if they get injured, if they have to stay there for a long period of time. We needed to also determine what kind of medical supplies we needed, what was necessary, what was just not necessary. We need scissors, gauze, that kind of stuff. And we wanted to make sure that it was easy storage and there was still room to operate when it was fully deployed so that it did not interrupt any other experiments or anything else that was going on at the time. So we had a few objectives. We wanted to perform some trade studies to see which materials would be the best and most efficient while still being economically sound. And we did a few other things such as movement analysis, make sure it could move properly, didn't get stuck or anything, and it would quickly deploy in case there was an emergency, so you wouldn't waste any time doing that. So our original design, we wanted to have a pull-out wall back here, and we dimensioned it based on kind of a military cot to optimize the space taken up. We didn't want it to be too wide or too long. We picked 72 because originally that's where the ladder was, and that's how far we could get the wall out. And that would give everyone except the tallest of astronauts plenty of room to lay down. So unless you have a 6'4 guy, he'll be a little uncomfortable, but if he's laying there, he has other things to worry about. So we also came up with the idea of a sort of quarantine or privacy option. We were going to think about putting a curtain up top. In case he's sick, we don't want anyone to get near him, or if it's a bad injury, kind of gruesome, no one wants to see that if they're doing an experiment. So we wanted a curtain that could fold around the bed so that you could either give him some privacy, or if he's sick or something, you can just kind of separate him away from the rest of the astronauts that are doing stuff. We wanted to integrate the storage on the inside of this wall here for the medical supplies so that when it pulled out, you could just reach in, grab whatever you need, work on them right in there, inside the quarantine as well. And it was designed based on the fact that only one person would have a major injury at a time that would require them to use the bed. Something like if someone, two people break their legs or something, you're just kind of thinking that only one person would have a huge injury at a time. So here is the folded out version that we originally came up with. Here is one we have based on a 6 foot tall astronaut. We had an extendable scissor design to pull out the wall or the bed right here, and can't see it really, but the supplies, there's also storage on the inside there, and it was designed to be pulled out by astronauts originally. And here's what it looks like folded up. This is this point of view right here, and this is a side view, kind of looking at it from the left there. And so I'm going to pass it on to Alex now, and he's going to tell you about how we adapted based on comments and suggestions that we received from NASA and our professors.
Hi, everyone. As Brandon just introduced me, I'm Alex. I'm going to walk you through how we went from this design that we presented at CDR in early January and how we incorporated the feedback we got from that meeting. So the main takeaway was that the assembly really needed to deploy quickly and automatically, so single press the button as automatic as possible. And the second point was that we needed to kind of limit the footprint of that assembly so that we don't have to compromise between, say, an experiment going on and the need for medical assistance. The scissor mechanism we just introduced seemed a little clunky, and that's really what came out of the presentation. also possibly uncomfortable. So during that presentation, we debated a few other options, which we pursue later on this year. So this is the extensible scissor design that we ultimately rejected due to the sharp edges which can be a hazard inside the habitat, and ineffective in zero G because it'd be hard to pull out without ground support. During the presentation, we also
quick question: is this for a zero G application or a partial G application or both?
Technically, I think it's for both. It's designed to be used in transit if needed, and then once on Mars.
That's another reason the scissors were taken out, because we didn't take into account zero G. So that's another reason we ended up taking it out, because we wanted to include that just by the off chance we did have to deploy this in zero G. So
I might say that the HAB it's in is a Martian HAB, so it is not at zero G.
So we also presented this design, which consisted of a inflatable membrane filled with compressed air or nitrogen. The risk of puncture during medical intervention was quite high, so that's why we discarded it. Second con was the effects of long-term storage. We didn't know how that would affect the surface of the membrane. Finally, we went for a piston approach. So you can see on the left here the underfloor piston approach, which we discarded because we didn't have the floor space under the habitat. And on right is the vertical option, which we developed further. You can see that the pistons are actually inverted. We have one going downwards and the other one going upwards. This needed to be refined because we didn't have the overlap necessary to make sure that the design would function correctly inside the habitat. We also didn't have any sort of vertical adjustment possible from the specific design. So this is what we ended up coming and developing. You can see that the piston on the wall that doesn't move is, in fact, in the second floor of the rehab, and both of them are now pointing down. So why hydraulics? Well, they're pretty reliable. That way we ensure that we can support the weight of an astronaut. And in order to make everything automatic, we decided to program it using Arduino and just link the entire hydraulic system through it. That way we can just press the button, have the entire thing deployed, and retract. So those are the parts. We ended up choosing some specifications. Two different piston stroke sizes. The smaller one goes inside the deployable wall, and the entire structure moves along vertical and horizontal rails, which I'm going to show you in a second. So those are the horizontal rails. We selected that wheel assembly simply because it would prevent the entire bed assembly from rotating, counteract the moment. And here are the vertical rails for guiding.
In an emergency situation, it may be sometimes that power is not available. Is there a mechanism that this could be deployed unpowered by a group? Or is it, if there's no power with a hydraulic system, are you stuck?
So since on Mars, since both of them are downwards facing, we could have the entire assembly release the pressure, and I think that would actually swivel the entire assembly. We didn't really think about that.
Yeah, but you should be able to pull it out completely manually as long as you release the pressure from the pistons.
An important consideration for
another
procedures and powered systems in a remote environment.
Another option, we could make it power independent and have it run off a battery, but it would just limit the amount of times that you could use it.
Okay, I'm going to give the presentation to Atticus. He's going to walk you through what you've done so far.
All right, so like Alex said, my name is Atticus Mullon. I'm the architecture chief of the group. I'm going to take you through kind of some progress photos of what we've completed on our design so far. So with our final design in hand and our parts beginning to arrive via mail, we went into our rehab and did a close inspection of our initial steps needed to integrate our designs. If you go into our rehab and start kind of peeking around the outer walls and things, you'll realize it's pretty typical dimension lumber framing in the walls. However, we needed to reconfigure some of the framing, and we need to really take some of the skin off. It's clad in OSB all around, and we thought that'd be, you know, pretty simple, but as we found out, last year's group was very thorough in their construction, and they painted and puttied and disguised every screw that they could, and when we tried to remove that OSB, we could not find all of them. And, so that was our first change was, in the interest of time and cost, we sacrificed some OSB, got, you know, some corners ripped up and just pried it off. So we could get in there and get started. We took the ladder off so that we could have more space to work and get under the floor panels that were kind of holding it in. It was also really sturdily in there. So moving on step by step, these are the assemblies that we've completed so far. The bed assembly, the bed frame, is completed. We, in the interest of time, went to our local hardware store and looked for pre-measured lengths of pipe and things that we could use. Luckily, they had 6-foot lengths of this 3/4-inch pipe. They had tees. We utilized all those components to make our bed assembly. You see on the tip here, this piece right here was a set of rollers we ordered. They were called by a company called Pacific Bearing Company. Those are used to. Our goal is to use them to minimize the moment as you sit on the edge of the bed, so that the piston doesn't have to absorb all that at the center of the bed. So it's got these on either side, also to push the wall from a varying position as it rotates. Those may prove to be a problem for alignment, as we have two sets of those on each wall, then the two horizontal rails, and as we've started to put this in, we realize that's a little hard to align, and we're going to experiment with different ways to counteract the moment if these turn out to be too much of a problem. We've countersunk the holes, we've mounted them on the frames. This is the kind of outer wall that is very most base level right now. As you can see, those rails I was just talking about are integrated onto it. The bed frame fits snugly within it. We then took this, once we constructed it outside, put it in here in our rehab facility. We're starting to measure out where we need to place our upper and lower rails made out of Unistrut. We need to, it's kind of our next step. So, measuring on the floor. This alignment is crucial. We've had to really take moments, re-square beams that weren't anticipated to be this crucial to the process, because if there's not an equidistant from the floor to the ceiling the entire time, our bed could get jammed. We could have issues with deployment. So just looking at the process that we saw a video of earlier, right now we've done a little hand testing to determine if the concept, you know, has validity of any sort, and it of course does. There's a completely concealed. All the logistics work out as anticipated. Next step, kind of this halfway mark. We did it with our hands, hand powers. We don't have the hydraulics hooked up yet. You know, you push down on one side and up on the other, and it seems to work fine. Our alignments will all have to be worked out in the final position where its height is sitting here. Also, one reason we did the pistons as we did, where one goes down and the other one goes down, is that we got this kind of interstitial zone between the heights of the pistons, and we can actually move the bed up and down to adjust for, you know, say, I don't know, different activities or different, you know, procedures you may have to perform on an injured individual or the person that's performing them. You can adjust the bed height.
What's the range, the angle range that you're available to you with this kind of design?
The up down range.
Yeah. What kind of, you know, can you get both up and down, and mm-hmm. how many degrees?
You can, I think our base height was 36 inches or something like that. And then if you want to adjust the bed's horizontal height, it's about 12 inches of linear movement. Mm-hmm. And I think that goes from 36 to 24. So, you know, it could be here, or if you've got a shorter astronaut that's doing that.
And you can adjust it so that one side is 36, the other side is 24.
You can, yes, as well. Of course, you can make the angle
is important.
The angle is more variable than even the horizontal height is. Back piston has a lot of stroke that's variable, so you could make the angle very variable.
They'd just be up pretty high.
Right. That's one option, yeah. As the angle increases, the head height will be a little bit, maybe too high in some cases.
Yeah, I mean, there's also patient comfort versus operability on the patient. And, you know, if you've been to the hospital much, patients all have different ways they like to sit when they're stuck. So some like their heads high, some like their heads low, some like to be horizontal. Having the widest range available to you to make sure somebody's comfortable is important.
Yeah, that's very true. I think we may not even have considered the implications of that, but I'm happy that our design accommodates that. So these are kind of the remaining tasks that we have in construction. Obviously, a big one is the attachment of the hydraulic cylinders. We have had some additional moment braces plasma cut with a CNC machine. Just anticipating that need, I was doing some plasma cutting for another class, so I threw them in the file. The hydraulic system assembly, we've got our pumps, they're in-house, we've got our cylinders, everything's arrived, we need to put hydraulic fluid in them and get them ready. Alex is going to work on the Arduino programming to make sure that the cylinders, during deployment, it's not a big issue if they get to their desired position at different times. It's going to achieve its horizontality, but once they're there, if we want to have simultaneous up-down movement, they have to equal in speed, and they have different bore sizes. So we're going to have to vary the amount of hydraulic fluid going into each one. So that's a little bit of Arduino work that Alex is confident we can perform. Once we get all that put together, we're going to test the system using live people, spacesuits, everything. And we're going to do a demonstration and a video. So at this point, I'll hand it over to Joseph.
And my name is Joseph Stephan, and I'll kind of just go over what we have left. So basically, going to go over our success criteria. So what do we consider successful build and successful deployment? So the following criteria is it needs to deploy safely. It needs to deploy quickly. It needs to be able to hold the person, so it needs to be structurally robust. We don't want any failures while anyone is lying on the bed, or, especially during deployment, we don't need failures with that too. Like I said, we're going to have issues with the railing. We need to make sure that those are lined up. The hydraulic cylinders, we're going to make sure those are operational, and like I said as well, that we have, you know, there's going to be issues with making sure that they line up correctly and varying the hydraulic fluid for those. So that's just kind of what we would consider a successful deployment. It deploys quickly, it works, and it can sub quickly as well. And then it holds a person, and in a comfortable way too. I guess this is just more of our success criteria. The wall moves out. We want it to work with just the push of a button. So you push one button, it deploys, you push another button, and it stows away. And then also, in deployment, you push a button, and you can raise and lower it and adjust the angle of the bed. Reiterating some of the things I said. No electrical lines, no faults with those, no danger of being electrocuted. So we need to have our wires safely stored and hidden away. And then also, we want to do a system demonstration. So at the end, what we'd like to do is just kind of a video demonstrating a simulated mission on Mars. He's in a spacesuit, somehow gets injured, maybe a rock falls on his arm, or just he injures himself in some way. So he's taken back into the rehab, and he deploys the bed. The bed deploys. The astronaut is placed on the bed, and then they continue to work on him, fix the issue, whatever it may be, broken arm, a scratch, and then, show him resting or what needs to be done, and then whenever he's healed or properly or able to move around again, he gets up and you push the button, and the bed stows away. So it's kind of, just a way for us to test it, see how it works, and see, kind of get some feedback on how comfortable is the bed, can we adjust the bed, to make it more comfortable for the person, just kind of different criteria along that. So just a simulated mission and a video along with that, I think. And then, so risk mitigation, there's going to be risks involved with this design, and so we need to kind of foresee those risks and mitigate them as best as we can. Cylinder pump failure, this is probably one of the most critical risks, or one of the most impactful, I guess, yeah, critical risks. But the probability of this occurring, we felt, was pretty low. It's something that we need to take into account and something we need to look for, but we don't think it's going to be too big of an issue. Because if our cylinder does, or our cylinder is compromised, it really does ruin a lot of the, you know, push button capability. But there is still a mechanical way to open the bed, as Jamey said earlier, Dr. Jacob. You can just pull the bed out mechanically. Failure to implement proportional cylinder rates, so that's going to be an issue. It's a minor issue, but it's got a higher probability of occurring. That's just going to affect how the bed raises and lowers and kind of the angles that we can get with that. And so that's really going to be affected by the Arduino and the programming, is getting those cylinder rates. Railing wheel failure. So we feel that's going to be a low probability of occurring because we're going to make sure we test our railing quite thoroughly, make sure everything runs smoothly and can pull out. And then when we install those pistons, you know, run slow tests and really make sure that those railings are lined up. And then deployment-related injury, you know, when it's deploying, we need to make sure that nobody's in the way of the path, and especially when it's stowing, there's nobody, you know, nobody's arms anywhere near anything that, you know, can get pinched, or because those pistons, they're rated pretty high, so there is a possible chance of injury with those.
Is there a mechanism to assure that if somebody did have their hand caught or something like that, that if the power requirement goes over a certain amount, you know, because it's pushing too hard, it'll...
We don't have that, and to be honest, it's going to be a little hard with how highly rated our pistons are, because our pistons are rated for upwards of, they're rated pretty high, because the issue was stroke length. We needed a long stroke,
But it does come down to, you talked about having, sorry to interrupt, but you talked about having to program the Arduino for the cylinder rates. But by the same token, you could solve that problem as well as the other problem by throwing in something like either a small gyro or even if you use something like an opto interrupter and just had something slipping through the little gaps. This way you knew exactly what rate you're going. So this way, if something did happen and you did have to stop, it would automatically pick it up as an encoding.
Okay. So you would insert a gyro?
You could do that. That's one, yeah. Depending on what type of gyro you got. And SparkFun makes them cheap. I think they're less than $50.
Okay. Yeah, we'll definitely look into that. I guess I didn't think of that issue. Or not that issue, but just that way of kind of solving that problem.
It's an important consideration for your own safety in this device, but also for deployment in an emergency situation for NASA. It's likely that if this is going to be deployed in an emergency, people are thinking about a lot of other things, and it would be very easy to have something in the way of the deployment, and you don't want it to, you know, crush somebody or something, or, you know,
yeah.
There's an IV bag that's the critical medical piece of equipment. It fell on the floor just as you're deploying, and you don't want to smoosh it. So it's a good thing for, you know, your a good consideration for your device as it would go to Mars as well.
We'll definitely look into it, especially if it's something so cheap as just a $50 part. So that's something we'll take into and look into. And then just kind of our cost analysis, what we've purchased so far and what we plan to purchase. And just, you know, what our remaining budget is left. And then just a kind of cost breakdown. So incidentally, our pump is one of the most costly parts of this project, as well as our pistons, so those take up, you know, the biggest chunk of our budget. And then everything else is kind of smaller parts, cheaper parts. And then this is just kind of, you know, our Gantt chart, where along in the timeline we are, and what we kind of have planned next, and how far we need to, you know, get within the next, you know, month or so. And then I'll just go ahead and move on to the next
part. Let me interject real quick. Could you go back one thing for the answer? So this, I appreciate you having that up here. So one thing I didn't do to set the stage properly is this
This review was the fourth or fifth milestones from the X-Hab program. This is kind of a checkpoint review. So in the fall and the early spring, they did a SDR, a PDR, and a CDR to get their design done. And then this is kind of a checkpoint review. And it's kind of between that final CDR and their final demonstration just to see what they're doing, what their progress is. So they're showing a lot of stuff that's incomplete. But what happens is in the final report next month, end of April or early May, we'll see their final product. So this is kind of an interim report. And we don't have a lot of structure of this one because the other ones are more formal. It's an SDR, PDR, CDR,
right,
certain products. This one really asks them to just show us what you're doing, what you're working on, where you're at, tell us any issues. So it's kind of, I should have set the stage for that a little bit better. Sorry to interject that.
Oh, right.
Thank you, Tracy.
And I guess we'll continue with our second project.
So for the second project sub-team, it was for the zero-gravity exercise equipment. These are the numbers.
You have to speak up a little bit.
Yeah. No,
we have someone online.
Okay, so for our objectives initially, this is going to go over pretty much when we started last semester into before the CDR. Just going to update on that, and then I'm going to go into where we're at with the treadmill now. So objectives: prevent muscle atrophy, obviously, by using cardio, workout, and all this to keep the astronaut fit so that they can perform their missions in space. Obviously, muscle atrophy is a big problem. Here shows 180 days, reduces muscle mass by 40%. Assumptions that we took into consideration. So we're assuming 3 to 9 months in transit there, and about 6 astronauts each performing 2.5 hours of exercise a day. And we're also assuming that the transat is using the sweat collection system that ISS currently uses. And we're also assuming a horizontal transit layout. So for requirements, ability to work in zero G, obviously. It's easy to test these on Earth with gravity, but also has to be able to perform it in zero G as well. And with the astronauts, 6 astronauts, 2.5 hours exercise each a day, obviously it needs to be durable as well. And the other thing to consider is the use of space. So the trans have not a lot of space. We want to make sure that we didn't waste space, so to implement it, put it in areas where we don't take up use of space. So also target a variety of muscle groups. So treadmill and rowing machine, obviously they hit a large variety of muscles, so that's why we took consideration using those two components. This is the fall layout for the MPLM. Obviously, notably, there's the treadmill. The rowing machine's not shown in this. I think that was before we decided to go with the rowing machine also, but most notably is a horizontal layout. So here's the, for the, most of the characteristics for the treadmill. Maintain cardio, aerobic type exercises, and the benefits from that as well. Design, gonna have, so we just used an off-the-shelf treadmill with the use of bungees. This shows 2 bungees, but our new design, current design, is going to use actually 4, like the Colbert uses, with 4 points in each corner. And the user is going to wear a harness, so harness straps over the shoulders with a belt, and then the 4 bungees would essentially connect to each side of that. So here is what we inherited. This is the initial treadmill layout that was in TransHab. Before, it had floor covers, so I guess it wasn't being used as much as what we're considering now. So before they have floor covers that can be removed magnetically with the magnets and pulled up and used, and then also put back on to allow that space to be used. But, this one has two straps, like I said before. Okay, so for the CDR feedback, a little bit ago, the main points we got were to separate the row machine and the treadmill, because before we were going to place the row machine on the wall so that it could use the resistance straps from the treadmill. But because there are 6 astronauts, 2.5 hours each, we decided, we're told that it'd be a good idea to just separate those so that 2 astronauts could work out at a time. So we separated those so 2 astronauts can work out at a time, one on the treadmill, one on the row machine. And also, now we're looking at generating electrical power from the row machine, so we're going to hook up a DC motor and send that power to a battery cell.
Question, during your trade studies and analyses early on, did the team consider a cycle ergometer as an option? And if you did, why? You know, what was the reason you traded it out and just chose these two devices?
If I remember correctly, I believe a cycle was looked at also. I think they just went on the use of a row machine. The treadmill, we already had that, so. In the rowing machine. I think the use for that was because they were going to have them work in tandem with one another using these straps, the bungees from the treadmill.
We also felt that the bicycle would have a similar benefit to the treadmill with the cardiovascular benefits, mm-hmm. and that a rowing machine kind of adds a strength component and a muscular component for both the body that's beneficial.
You're trying to cover the whole body.
Exactly.
Minimally.
Yep.
Okay. Minimal hardware.
So this is where we're at currently with the treadmill. We removed the floor panels, and we actually lifted the treadmill up now, so it's essentially flush with the floor now. What we have left to do is to add permanent floor paneling around that, as you can see, cover up the structure there, and to also attach the 4 bungees to the 4 points of the treadmill. And now, I'm going to get this over to Zach. He's going to go over the row machine.
I'm Zach, and I'll be going over part of the rowing machine. So this is kind of our initial concept for the rowing machine. As you can see, we kind of have it in a vertical layout right here, but we're also going to be testing it in 2 configurations. Our earth analog will be in the horizontal on the floor, since obviously it'll be kind of hard to test in a vertical layout like that. But we're going to also mount it on the wall just to have that configuration as well. And we're also going to be connecting the rowing motion to a DC motor to help generate and take the power out of that. And we'll be able to use that in other ways. And so we're going to store that power in a battery cell, and then you'll be able to use that power in any way that you see fit to use. What we've done so far is we've assembled and positioned the rowing machine, and what we have left to do is that we'll just need to connect the motor and the batteries, the power pack and everything, so that that's all working. And so right here in this picture, we just have it sitting in the horizontal layout, and that's kind of where we're going to be testing the electrical generation in that orientation. So right here you can see picture of the 2 different orientations and configurations that we have. this one on the right is the vertical. We don't have it attached to the wall yet, but that's just to kind of give you guys the idea. So we still need to attach it to the wall in that configuration, but then we also have the earth analog that we're going to be doing most of our testing in on the left. And so here's just kind of our power estimate that we're expecting to get out of the rowing machine. We estimated that a single astronaut could generate about 150 to 200 watts when he's using the machine. And so we sized our motor based off of that information to a 24 volt DC motor. And so based off of the amount of time that they're going to be using the machine, we estimated that you could generate about 45 kilowatt hours per month total. And so that would be quite a bit of power. And so the solar panels from our research, we decided that it was about 11 kilowatts or so, and so that'd be a pretty generous amount that we could add to that. And so any power's help, because since we're getting further away from the sun, there's less solar energy available, and so just anything helps. So that's what we're expecting, and then we're obviously going to do some testing once we get everything built. So I'll pass on to Fabian to talk about
some more. Thanks. So these are some of the parts that we're looking at using to extract power from a rowing machine. We've got a DC motor and just a classic Duracell power pack that people use to jump start their cars and similar things. Then we need a charge controller to make sure that there's not too much energy flowing into the power pack to protect that. And then also we've got a blocking diode to prevent any discharging from the power pack while the treadmill is not in use, the rowing machine is not in use. So we've got a little schematic just showing what we're planning on implementing from the rowing machine. This will be the rowing machine, and we're going to have a belt attached to the DC motor, which will then attach to the charge controller through wiring, through the blocking diode to charge the power pack. These are some of the test procedures we want to implement. We want to test that the wall mount is safe and secure, and we're exploring some options of trying to get one of our team members via a harness to have them maybe mount the wall-assembled rowing machine as well, so that we can test that there's enough range of motion and that it's usable without interfering in the space of the treadmill as well, because we're looking at having both of these instruments working at the same time, this equipment, so that if need be, we can have several astronauts exercising at the same time, save time and space. We're also going to test the collection mechanism for energy from the rowing machine, seeing how much energy we can actually extract in the end from the rowing machine, and also seeing if we can hook the battery up to maybe a monitor or something else so that we can directly use that energy. We also need to make sure that the rowing machine straps in the astronaut securely in a zero-g environment. We don't want them floating off into space while rowing. This is the cost justification we've been doing so far. We've spent about $1,000 on equipment. You can see the big portions of that is the rowing machine and the motor, as well as the battery pack and the electrical equipment. But we think we've bought all the big parts we need so far. It's just a matter of maybe another $100 or $200 for electrical.
I don't see it here, but is there a display where you'll know how much power you're producing? Are you going to buy that and have it available? Or are you just, how are you going to measure, are you planning to measure power output when you use this?
Yeah, we already have some facilities in the lab to do that, so it's just a matter of picking those up.
Yes, we want to attach a voltmeter to the battery to check the kind of voltage that's on there, And then also the treadmill actually comes with a built-in mini computer that will give you information of how much power you're outputting at any given time when you're on the treadmill. So this is the timeline we've been following. Currently we're a trip to Kennedy Space Center is the second green highlighted portion. And we've outstanding is obviously the assembly of the motor to the power pack and the finishing touches on the train. Now I'll talk a little bit about some outreach we've been doing, so this is a different subject entirely. But for National Lab Day every year, which is about a week after our semester ends, we invite about 150 high school students in groups of seven over to the Richmond Hill facilities, which is where we have the SHARC set up. And we introduce them to what the X-Hab teams have been doing in the past years and what our team is coming up in May. We'll be introducing them to specifically what we've been doing this semester. Last year, for example, we ran through a simulated mission with the high school students. We had one team act as kind of crew in orbit, while the other crew descended down to Mars and had to receive instructions from the orbital crew about how to assemble a certain part through Millikin. Try doing that. We can see here that the students down in the right-hand corner, they're in the Oasis, and they had to assemble some Lego parts to complete the mission. This year we'll probably use the med bay to simulate a mission like that as well. Have one of the kids be an injured astronaut and then kind of run through the procedure of deploying a mission, as well as having some kids work out on the exercise equipment. This is the trip we took to campus, the positive campus. And this is Atticus working out on the call there. That's the first time it's been. Okay. Any questions?
So if we're thinking about the exercise equipment running each piece 7.5 hours a day, every day for several years, I mean, obviously that's a lot of wear and tear on the equipment. What kind of spares would you need for a mission to Mars, you know, or how do you make this, you know, so robust that things won't break, because this is such a crucial thing?
Well, we've been working with the assumption that we really only really looking at a 3 to 9 month trip to Mars, and then while on Mars, they can, with EVAs and just living in a reduced gravity environment, they can actually exercise independently from those. So those are really only for the transit.
Then also on the way back,
yeah, we have to look into what spares we have. We haven't really looked into that too much.
One thing we did look into was, for example, failures on the Colbert, and we weren't able to find a whole lot of data on that. So, you know, one thing kind of based upon is what you typically have at a gym, and how long the systems are made fairly durable as they're currently constructed. Unfortunately, we don't have a lot of information on what this.
The Colbert,
if you
implement
it,
it's really durable anyway. It's very heavy, and has a very robust. The shock absorption is very. That's a big part of the weight to not interfere with other experiments.
I can check with Robert Howard at JSC and see if they have anything you could share about that.
Yeah, and I think the contingency plan that there would be to figure out what parts you could manufacture using additive manufacturing in transit, and then what other critical parts you need to keep with you.
That's a good question, Joe. One of the things I think about at X-Hab is what the real flight architecture looks like. but then they're also trying to emulate it here on the ground, so there's some compromises. So looking at some of the flight design characteristics that we have to balance that a little bit, we can demonstrate on the ground as part of this project.
Are we at the general question and answer part yet, or are we still having more?
Oh, no, this is it.
No, this is
okay.
That's
a question specific to this. Did the treadmill folks learn from the rowing machine people that there's actually energy being input into the system that you could get up?
We thought about that. I'm making the treadmill generate energy as well.
You know, Nordic Track, which is very similar to a treadmill, actually has a flywheel like the rowing machine, and perhaps would be a better alternative if you're looking at, because you are exerting energy into the system, which is going to either show up as heat or as rowing people did, potentially as electrical current.
We did think about that. The one thing was with the zero G, really they would really have to exert a lot of energy on the treadmill, be tied down very tightly,
right,
to actually generate that energy, as opposed to just doing their cardiovascular, you know, and getting their body moving. So that's what we did actually look into that at the very beginning. And we said, nah, really, if we're going to study energy, we'll just study it from one standpoint, and that's the rowing machine.
Yeah, the treadmill modifications are minor, so we want to make it more usable than it currently is. Yeah, I think a Nordic Track is outside of our budget.
Potentially, yeah.
I noticed what you showed in your design so far for the treadmill. I think it shows the treadmill actually lower than the floor height.
Just,
and I wondered if you had considered the tripping hazard or the functionality of having the treadmill be just slightly below the floor, and it's such a... You've got a really small treadmill, and that would be the same in a spaceflight condition. Yeah. Having it lower than the floor height, could that cause trips? Could it make it difficult for somebody to get a good stride? You know, have you thought about that?
Well, our initial design was to make it reconfigurable so that we could cover the treadmill with floor panels. Mm-hmm. That's what we inherited from earlier teams.
Right, that's a valuable
which was good
design feature. Yeah,
exactly. But from the feedback we got during the CDR was that these exercise machines are going to be in use so much that it is viable to just designate an entire area of the MPLM to exercise and just have it permanently out. So that's why we moved away from the reconfigurable design and we raised the treadmill up, so now that it's flush with the floor now, and we went to a permanent
it is flush.
Either I didn't see that or I didn't notice you said it.
Awesome. Yeah, we went to that.
They didn't mention that.
Yeah, I think one thing we were curious about too, you know, so one of the benefits of keeping that flush, even though it could say maybe in use a lot, when it's not in use, it becomes more part of the floor instead. I think the tripping hazard is something we probably determine through testing, if that's an issue or not.
Did you, a lot of treadmill situations, in zero-G this wouldn't be relevant, but in a partial-G environment, the incline of a treadmill is something that people vary in order to get different muscle groups working, and consider the possibility of allowing for an inclining treadmill. And nobody, I mean, people here on Earth, a 6-degree incline is a pretty big deal. 2 degrees makes a difference for you if you're on a treadmill. I don't know. I don't think anybody really knows what's going to happen in a 3/8 G environment. Maybe people will like a 20-degree incline. Who knows? So, you know, what have you thought about the possibility of an inclining capability for a treadmill?
The treadmill we have out there right now does not have that capability. We inherited that. It's a fairly
just sold me some cool pistons, though, that could work.
Yeah, but that would be definitely an interesting possibility, especially because that's a way to get exercise in with low impact on joints and stuff.
This is in the zero G module, so this is the transit module.
That
so,
is okay.
so that is the transit module.
The module.
So I don't know if there'd be any advantage, but of course you could reorient the astronaut as well in a zero G. So, you know, with the straps, you could lean forward to achieve the incline.
If that was the desire. So I'm imagining in a zero G environment, that's not a big consideration.
Well, except for maybe the stride length will change.
Yeah, I could.
We have to look into that.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting to see if that actually does impact the way you run.
Right. One option to evaluate this, we could finally put our rotational mechanism that we've been wanting to manipulate in, so we can just rotate the entire thing.
Oh, yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about how you're going to do some of the testing, about having folks in there maybe do an exercise testing in parallel? And I know you mentioned you were going to do the video recordings of the deployment medical AI. Like, mm-hmm. about how you're going to test that before you do the video.
Yeah, I'll let you guys talk about the exercise one first in terms of parallel testing.
Yes, well, we're looking at having someone suspended from the basically ceiling of the MPLM to kind of simulate a zero G situation. We'll have to come up with a contraption to hook them up there so that we can have someone rowing on the wall in the wall mounted configuration while someone else is running to figure out if the space is enough in the horizontal layout. That doesn't really matter because we'll just have the in parallel next to each other. There's no concerns about space there. That's really just a testing configuration to see if we can extract the power, how much power we can extract, and how we can use that.
But also have them exercising simultaneously so you can see if there's an impact on having them be very close to one another.
Yeah, so I think that's really what Robert Howard wanted to see is the parallel ops.
Okay.
How it would work all together. About the medical
technology. Like along the way, obviously we'll have incremental component testing as we build it, just to make sure that, you know, we do everything we can along the way, make everything square and flush and the rollers lined up, and just piece by piece test it a little bit. And then ultimately, before we put anyone else in there, make a video of anything, you know, do a full dry run, deploy the entire bed, note any adjustments we need to make or any problems that come up. And then I'd say, before we make a video or anything, let's do the whole scenario ourselves, put people on the bed, put weight on the bed, see how it reacts, see any deflections, whatever needs to be adjusted.
I would say that the video is more of a proof of concept that we can display, whereas individual parts testing will both serve as a verification that parts work individually together, but also it might be a good way for us to see how to program the Arduino and the hydraulics before implementing them in final design.
I was thinking for that bed, you guys are going to have that port control on your hydraulic cylinder. If there's any consideration of, okay, are we going to jolt? You know, because you sound like you are going to adjust with the patient on board. So,
mm-hmm.
Right.
We are.
So,
yeah, the speed of the pistons will be in.
Right, kind of a ramp up rather than just a nominal.
That's true.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know how easy it would be to
especially
mix
if you've got a broken bone or something.
Right, right.
Nice. Feel really nice.
Yeah.
What medical procedure do you plan to emulate or simulate in your video?
Something
and how are you going to make that decision? On maybe something we could ask you guys, what would, I don't know if there's any research done, maybe the most possible likely injuries to occur on, you know, Mars or
yes.
Something, of course, NASA has that.
Do you know where to find it?
No. So, I didn't see any, you know, the two things that you designed are two things that NASA's authority on those designs and those needs are managed and owned by the Human Research Program at Johnson Space Center.
Oh, yeah.
So the Human Research Roadmap is JSC's online documentation for what they need, what NASA needs for a journey to Mars, and exercise devices and medical capabilities are, in fact, you know, two of the what they call risks to human health for exploration missions. And so if you just Google Human Research Roadmap, you'll find there 30-some risks to human health in space, and the three of them that you care about for this are the risk of adverse health outcomes and decrements in performance due to in-flight medical conditions.
Yeah.
So you read that and you'll find out what NASA thinks is going to require a bed, you know, on a journey to Mars. And then the other two, risk of impaired performance due to reduced muscle mass, strength, and endurance. That's obviously your exercise devices. Risk of reduced physical performance capabilities to reduced aerobic capacity. So if you just look up those three, you can go to the NASA authority that already tells you, you know, the body of research that's been done around the nation and the world
here's what NASA thinks. And you don't have to make a decision on your own, just refer to the authority. And then your video and your demonstrations of your exercise devices and your medical capability are going to be much more relevant to, you know, what NASA really thinks they need this for. So take a look at it.
Karen or Tim, do you
have anything? I have a question. I'm curious to know what you've learned during the process of the project, especially things that were unexpected that you learned from this.
How to take things into account for zero G, because we're so set on how things work here. So like initially we had people pulling out the bed, but when you're in zero G floating around, you can't set your feet and pull out the bed, things like that. So just adjusting for things like transit, maybe even reduced gravity. I mean, things don't work just exactly the same, so that was one of the big things.
It was also interesting to see that the previous work that was done and how you can test complex systems. Like we had a tour just now of these great high-tech facilities, and how the teams before us just built it with plywood and just a really low-tech kind of environment to simulate what needed to be done to focus on, you know, this is just the space we have, and whatever the space is made out of doesn't really matter if we're just exploring that space. That was really interesting.
How about team dynamics? Because that's something we take into account for human space flight, where you have find spaces with different personalities mixing together. Have you experienced some team dynamics as you've been working with one another?
Well, we really haven't had much confined space situations.
I could address that one.
Time crunch situation.
No one's locked us into it.
They only got a month to go, so maybe that day.
One of the things, of course, that I've really enjoyed about this whole process, and I think Dr. Jacob can echo this, is the team dynamics and the interdisciplinary nature. As you might notice, this is a quite homogenous group, other than we have a couple non-nationals, but basically they're all, you know, about the same. And we've had this dynamic before, and usually they work like men do. They do their stuff, they do it, but we've had other dynamics which I thought were very enriching, where we had a very diverse, last year we had a very diverse group, the year before, 2 years before that, we had a very diverse group. And it is interesting because you do have a lot of different types. People that want to tell everybody exactly how to do things, people that want to be told how to do things. But I think in large, they all work very well together, whatever their diversity is. This group, I haven't seen any real problem. We haven't put them in.
This one's fairly easy to work with everyone because it's firstly we're a fairly small group, and also we're all seniors and we've all chosen this project as our capstone. That's what we want to do. So everyone's on board and everyone's willing to actually, you know, do what.
I think the tightest they've been was last night, 9 people in a hotel room working on the project. I mean, that's a.
But. So you don't have any stragglers.
I think everyone's
No. This is probably the smallest group that we've had, and that's just kind of the way that our classes have kind of worked out. There's a big group last year that didn't pass a certain class, and so we had a lot of turnover, I should say. In our seniors.
And we had the ag group with us last year, so that added to the mix as well.
We had about 22 students working on the project last spring, and that was much more diverse in terms of both the disciplines and the makeup of the students.
So the interior design, it was
a very interesting experience.
We've only ever had one that's actually worked on the HAB itself, and
yeah,
she
they,
was 3 years ago.
They work on design aspects of the habitat. And unfortunately, our faculty, the architect and interior design that was interested in this project, retired 2 years ago, so we haven't been able to get that started again.
Yeah.
But of course, that was very diverse, just from the standpoint of where most of our engineers are male and most of the interior designers are female. And you're able to bring those two aspects together, and so that made that.
You really left out on that.
I think, too, as an architect, I mean, I've learned a lot from these guys just on realisticness of design and This is totally different from what I do in school mostly, so it's a lot, I'm used to more like, you know, design and artistic type of thought, and so they're always bringing me back down to reality.
Well, you can certainly...
more on the user requirements as you're getting your...
Yeah, they
But your pictures still look great.
Yeah, it's been an interesting experience for us, because on the traditional aerospace engineering side, we actually don't spend hardly any time on human factors. And so a traditional aerospace engineering curriculum doesn't consider that for the most part. You know, maybe you'll draw a cockpit, you know, around a spacecraft or an aircraft, but beyond that, you don't really consider it. So
whereas in architecture, we consider it almost on every project, but in a different way. Sociology of people, you know, environment of people, you know, experiential history, you know, so in terms of us, that's kind of the thing that we can really bring to the table. I think Scott Howe would actually talk about that as well, because that's that's really what the architect brings to the human factors group, is, you know, dealing with people in different ways, in how they interact with things, how they interact with each other, et cetera. And that's what architecture really is all about.
This has been a really good methodology for us to get that human factors experience into the undergraduate curriculum.
Well, I need to rush you guys along, but I appreciate everybody coming. I took a couple of notes here I wanted to follow up on. Eric, maybe you could send me a little note about the gyro that I'll pass on.
Whoever's working on that, like, more chance to talk about.
Okay.
Yeah, and I didn't mention it. So later on the semester, they will be going through a set of SOPs they have to get approved for. That takes all the safety considerations.
Good. And then I'll try to find some Colbert information from Robert Howard. And then if there's any videos or pictures you take over the next month that we can share with those guys, you know, if you can put them in Dropbox or something for me to share on that.
We'll do that.